for surgery to remove his gallbladder back in April of 2014. He stayed overnight for observation. His parents say learning the next morning he'd passed away from complications during the night was surreal.
We walked out and had no clue, nor did they express to us that they knew what could have happened to him. When they don't know what happened, the first thing they say is, he could have possibly thrown a blood clot. You know, we don't know that, we'll find out. He could have had a heart attack, you know, with, I mean, their guess as good as anybody's guess at that point.
Clearly something happened, because a young, healthy man is not going for outpatient surgery. Everything goes fine, and then all of a sudden passes. Not knowing was not an option for us, that we need to know what happened to him. We need to have an explanation of what happened to him.
We always had theories, but we didn't have any conclusive evidence for at least 9 months. And we finally got to the truth and to the bottom line. And that was a long process. That took a couple of years. There was a complication of errors and mistakes and lack of communication that was more systemic than just a single person making a mistake. And those categories led to what they call opioid induced respiratory depression. That's the technical term for what my son died of.
Gary's gotten in touch with an advocate who is spending her entire medical career in training nurses, talking to groups all over the country about this. We're even working with the hospital that Gary was at, and they are even working with this advocate for training, for retraining of the healthcare, for the nurses and doctors.
Opioid-induced respiratory depression occurs when an opioid is given for whatever reason, whether it is the patient that's shooting heroin or if it's an opioid prescribed for a pain problem. What opioids do is they increase the collapsibility of the airway. In the airway, I mean the space between the back of the throat and the top of the lungs. And they dull the central nervous system's effect to lowered oxygen levels and rising carbon dioxide levels. So technically what that means is that a patient is less likely to wake up and take a breath when their oxygen level is starting to dip down from that increased collapsibility of their airway.
Finding out what happened to Gary and learning about what took place or didn't take place in the hospital that day has been a very eye-opening and, quite frankly, a very shocking, shocking experience. We thought Gary was in the best of care.
We have published guidelines that guide nurses into what best monitoring practices would be for the patient that is being administered opioids in the hospital setting for acute pain. So in those guidelines, what it says is that nurses should measure three parameters on their patient. One is their oxygen level, and that is measured with an electronic device, usually pulse oximetry. The second one is a respiratory rate and the depth of their respiration and the quality of their respiration. So it's not just counting how many times the patient is breathing a minute, but it's really listening for snoring. It's really looking for the depth of their respiration. And the third thing is sedation level. So what we know is that before a patient respiratory arrests, they have a decrease in their consciousness. And a lot of times what we see is the patient is just drowsy. When you walk up to the bedside, they wake a little bit more slowly. When they do wake up, they look at you a little bit, but you know, just trying to figure out where they are and who they are. So it takes them a little bit longer to acclimate to what the environment is. When we start seeing that in the setting of opioids, we know that this person has probably had enough opioid, and we need to look at different avenues for pain management.
Hospitals need to have the appropriate processes and procedures in place. They need to have the appropriate training. The people who are administering or treating the patients need to be held accountable for actually following through the appropriate procedures that the hospital has in place. There were multiple checkpoints along the way from the time that Gary was admitted into the emergency room on April 17th to the moment that he passed on the morning of April 18th. Moments where things should have been caught. There were multiple handoffs of information. And when Gary came into the emergency room, there's a whole list of questions that they asked him. Is this somebody who's, you know, what they consider obese, somebody who's been a smoker, somebody who has a thick neck, somebody who may have sleep apnea, somebody who is snoring? And all of these risk factors put Gary at a higher risk of opioid-induced respiratory depression. And yet nobody throughout every single checkpoint in the hospital relayed that or connected those dots. And because he wasn't being monitored properly, knowing that he was at a higher risk of opioid-induced respiratory depression, no alarms, nothing was set off to let any of the medical staff know that something was wrong. If they had gone in and they had actually followed through on what they should have followed through with, he would be here with us today.
So one of the parameters that nurses should use when they're assessing patients is pulse oximetry. Pulse oximetry is really standard of practice. You know, you go to your doctor's visit, they put a little probe on your finger and it tests how much oxygen is in your system.
That little clip on his finger would have told them that he is shutting down, and they would have been able to save him.
If the facility would have followed at least the minimum of best practices of monitoring, my son would be alive today. If the communication would have followed, he'd be alive today. If they would have done their training as they were trained to do, he'd be alive today. If they would have followed up on their accountability to make sure that he was alert and not just allow him to sleep, he'd be alive today. Monitoring within the hospitals needs to move not only just from best practices, which did not happen in this case, but more to fact patient care. And what that means is, what are the facts of that particular patient? Those should be determined, and then that will define the level of monitoring. And it's not, and monitoring should not be generic.
We want people to be aware of this issue. That it is happening, and it can happen to anyone. It can happen to anyone.
This actually happens thousands of times in the United States every year. There are actually people that are dedicated in the medical field to make sure that what happened to my son doesn't happen again. So this is bigger than just my son. And that is what keeps our feet on the ground right now. This is why we're reaching out. And our objective is to bring the awareness to this, that I don't think there's a family in the United States right now that doesn't have a family member or a friend or someone that they know that is going to go in the hospital this year for some simple procedure. And this can happen.
We want everybody in America to say the first thing they're going to ask their health providers is, how are you going to monitor me? What drugs, medications will I be receiving before, during, or after surgery? And how will you monitor my respiratory? That's the first thing everybody has to ask. We lost our son, and we can't lose him for nothing. And you can prevent it from happening just by having the education. We would never know any of this
if it didn't happen to our son.
I'd like to see an absolute wide opening where there's no patient harm happening. This is something that can be prevented. Opioid-induced respiratory depression is absolutely 100% preventable. No deaths should be occurring. None. Zero.